related to virtual memory, but it relates to how the disk is used in the virtual memory hierarchy. First, a few announcements. The midterm is in 1 week from today, in case you hadn't remembered. Unfortunately, I've not given you a lot of information about the midterm yet, except I'm telling you now that it's covering lectures 1 through 8, that is everything including this lecture, but not what's going to be on Tuesday's lecture. These chapters in the 3 Easy Pieces book, I actually added one more chapter compared to the comment I made on Canvas when someone asked. But I'll go back and edit that. The ideas in projects 1 and 2 will be covered, and of course homework 1 as well. There'll be short answer questions like the first homework assignment, and you'll also, I think, have to read some code either from XV6 or from another operating system, or perhaps from user code. And answer some quick questions about that. It'll be in class, so it'll only be like an hour and 20 minutes long. You can bring one sheet double-sided of notes just in case there are things that you feel that are difficult to memorize. And that's all I have to say about the midterm right now. Hopefully I'll have some practice questions to send you. I'm not promising anything, but we'll see how that goes over the weekend. Okay. Project 2 is due in 11 days, that is a week from Monday. I changed the instructions slightly because the extra credit should have said 159 pages should be available to the processes. I don't know if you guys remember that part of the assignment, but the extra credit is changing the implementation of shared memory so that if you're not using shared memory, you can still use those 4 pages for regular memory. But in that case, you only have 159 pages total because the first page was dedicated to protecting against the null pointer exception, so it actually should be 159. And I added a couple of hints to the instructions over the past few days, so you might want to reread the instructions, the hints in the instructions. And I might add some more later. Okay, any questions about that stuff? Yes. Yeah, the cheat sheet can be typed if you want, just like no magnifying glasses or microscopes. it's gonna be typed. I think that's fine. Yeah. Anyone else? If you want to share cheat sheets, like photocopy and give it to your friends, I mean, that's fine as well, I guess. Okay. Last lecture, we talked about virtual memory for the second time, but in more detail. I showed the details of page tables and page table entries. So hopefully you have a clear idea of the mechanisms behind virtual memory. And in particular, I showed how the low bits in the page table entry are used to indicate information that the OS can use and that the hardware can use for various things. So for example, the lowest bit in the page table entry indicates whether the page is present. So that can be set by the OS to 0 in order for the in order to cause the CPU to raise an exception if a user process tries to access memory in a certain range that's not supposed to use. So that's what's happening in the homework assignment, or the first project with the null pointer page, the first page where the null pointer is. And you can also use those bits to configure pages that they're only read-only as opposed to read-write, or that they're accessible only to the kernel in privileged mode. I talked about the translation look-aside buffer, which was used to reduce paging latency. So without something like a translation look-aside buffer, this idea of adding paging for virtual memory translation could mean that you have several additional memory accesses every time you have a memory access, especially like if you have a 4-level page table. Those 4 levels of the page table are in 4 different memory locations. So you could have like 4 memory reads plus the final read that you're doing. That would be really slow. You don't want that to happen because memory is generally much slower than registers. So clever CPU designers came up with the idea of a translation look-aside buffer, which is a cache of part of the page table that most recently was used. In other words, those page table entries that from the low lowest level of the page table that that were most recently used are stored in the processor very close to where computation is happening. So maybe about 128 cache entries would be there for translations to happen very quickly without having to go through the page table. All right, and I introduced the terminology of a cache hit and a cache miss just to describe the different scenarios when you are able to use a cache, that's a cache hit, and you can quickly get your memory translation, or a cache miss when you cannot find the information you need in the cache. In other words, that short list of recently used entries is not one of the ones that you're looking for, and in that miss case, you have to go to main memory, do those extra lookups to get the page table that you need, okay? That solved the problem of paging latency to a large extent. I mean, there still are cases when paging introduces latency, but for the common case, TLB solved the problem. And then the problem of page tables taking up too much space was solved by having multi-level page tables, two levels, four levels, three levels, whatever. And that allows you to basically omit big chunks of the page table that are storing all zeros anyway, because you have a small high-level index or directory that is a summary of the low-level table that has short entries indicating that a whole chunk of the page table is missing. Questions about that? Yeah, let's move on to new material. So swapping is the idea of taking parts of virtual memory and storing them on disk. You probably remember from the diagram and from your experience, of course, that disks are much larger than RAM, random access memory, but they're slower. So it makes sense to add disks to the mix to use in certain scenarios, but obviously the slowness of disks can cause problems, and we'll see that. So paging allows many processes to share the same physical memory. Every process has its own virtual address space, but and then, you know, each process can have a very large address space. That's nice for a lot of reasons that we've been talking about, particularly that programs don't have to be aware of how much RAM is really in the system. It's convenient for the programmer, both as like a C or high-level programmer, but also if you're doing assembly programming, and also for the compilers that generate assembly code. It's very convenient to just make the assumption that you can use an arbitrary, very large address space and not have to worry about this, you know, this particular machine only has 128 megs of RAM, therefore I have to, like, if I'm going to use more than that amount, I have to somehow manually copy part of my data to some other location, like a disk, or to, like, clean up what I've done previously. That additional bookkeeping would make programming a lot more difficult. And that's not how it's done. It could have been how, it used to be how it was done before paging in virtual memory. But it's convenient to have virtual memory. But the problem is, of course, when physical RAM is fully consumed, and it's not just a matter of like fitting multiple processes in a space where they're translating their addresses to a different range, but also that that there is not physical space for everyone, and the OS still has to kind of allow programs to use large virtual memory spaces, even though it doesn't have the physical space to give to all those processes, right? And the options the OS has when reacting to a scenario when the RAM is fully consumed are roughly two options. First of all, just give up and kill the memory hog process. So the process is using too much memory, just kill it. That could be a valid approach in some scenarios. And actually, many machines don't have swapping. Like a smartphone doesn't really have a disk per se. It has flash storage, which is a type of disk. So depending on the smartphone model, you might not have swapping. So it could be that if you run an app that takes up too much memory, it gets killed and it crashes. Like, you see smartphone apps crash all the time compared to desktop applications. But the second option, which we're going to talk about today, is to free up some physical memory by temporarily moving pages to disk. And like we said, the disk is large, maybe 100 times bigger than random access memory, but it's very slow. And we're hoping that that some of this memory that processes claim to be using and have used in the past is not really going to be needed very much in the future. We hope that we can find some parts of some pages of memory to put on disk without causing too much of a performance penalty. Right? That's the crux of this whole scheme. Right. Like I mentioned before, we have a hierarchy of storage in computers from registers down to disks, and things get much bigger and much slower as we go down. What I want to highlight now is just three parts of it. Okay, the random access memory, SSDs, and magnetic rotational disks. So we call both of these disks. And swapping occurs between RAM and either one of these two types of storage devices, depending on what you have in your system. You could even have both. You could have multiple SSDs, multiple disks, whatever. But basically, generally, swapping is always between RAM and one of these block storage devices down here. And like I said, the magnetic disk is about 100 times larger than RAM, but it has 10,000 times higher latency. 10,000 times higher latency than memory. And of course, we already said that memory is much slower than registers, so we're talking really slow. If we have an SSD, it's definitely faster than a magnetic disk, but it's still it's only about 10 times faster in terms of latency. So we're still getting seeing 1,000 times longer delays to access data that's stored on SSD compared to in RAM. All right. So we want to work as much as possible in the top levels of the storage hierarchy, and somehow have policies that find large and rarely needed data to store it in the bottom level of the hierarchy. We don't want to put the burden on the programmer to tell us ahead of time what parts of the program are going to be recently used versus not recently used, because A, we can't trust the programmer necessarily to do that. B, we have different programs running at the same time, and they may not be nice to each other, and they may lie to us about what they're really going to use to try to improve their performance. So we need to actually use observations to make these decisions. Okay, so swap pages are stored on disk, like I said. These are the same pages that we talk about in Project 2 and that we've been talking about for page tables. You know, so typically a 4 kilobyte chunk of memory that's contiguous. Could be larger pages if you're talking about super pages or huge pages. But where on disk are they stored? What do I mean stored on disk? So it depends on the system. On Linux, so first of all, XP6 doesn't have swap space. That's just one observation. So if you run out of memory with XP6, the OS has to kill a process or crash altogether. But on Linux, swap space is usually a special optional disk partition. So if you have one hard drive in your machine, you actually might divide it into 4 different segments just because Linux works that way. One of them, like a relatively small segment, maybe like a few tens of gigabytes, would be swap space. So there's you can't put files there as a user. Like, you can't save anything there that's dedicated for swap use. And the OS kind of divides it into page-sized chunks to store pages in there. And then you have other partitions for your files. But on Windows, traditionally, there's not a dedicated swap partition, but Windows just creates a special file called pagefile.sys, which is in your normal file system, like on your C drive or whatever. And that allows Windows to like expand that file as needed to store pages, or it can shrink it down to nothing if no swap space is needed. So the advantage there, I guess that's a more flexible scheme in the sense that the same free space is shared between user files, system files, and pages for swapping. So you can choose to allocate your space to files or to swapping, but with a dedicated chunk of swap space like on Linux, the advantage is that you never accidentally have a user like using up all the disk space and therefore preventing programs from having the swap space they might need. Right? So there's a little bit of a trade-off there. As you might imagine, SSDs compared to magnetic disks, solid-state disks, are ideal for swap space because they're faster than magnetic rotational disks, but they're more expensive. And like I recently installed an SSD in one of my home machines for swap space, and that made a big difference compared to using the magnetic RAID array I had previously, which should have been pretty high performance, but yeah, SSDs are good for swap. Okay. Questions? Yeah? I think I do sometimes, but They can. There's no reason not to, I guess, except that there is a limited swap space on, like, there's a limited SSD space on the smartphone. Yeah, there's no, I guess there's no reason why a smartphone wouldn't have swapping using its SSD. Yeah. But SSDs are kind of small, so there's not a ton of space to spare. All right. So let's just show a simple example, just theoretically speaking, where we have physical memory and swap space on a magnetic disk, where, you know, again, this is a toy example where we just have four pages of space in physical memory, but we have twice as much space available on our disk for swap space, okay, eight pages. So in total, this allows us to run processes that are using up to 12 pages of disk space. And the OS has to decide at a given time which processes are using the memory. Like, we already talked about that before, what parts of memory are allocated to what processes, but also in particular which like overflow pages are swapped out to the disk, okay? And the important thing to remember is that a program can't use this memory while it's in swap space, okay? Like, if the CPU has an instruction that says read from location 10,000, we know that the page tables allow this mix-up of the location. In other words, the page table allows the processor to figure out where in physical memory the OS placed that page, even if it's not in the virtual address that the program thinks it's working in. But there's no mechanism like a page table for the processor to see, oh, this page is swapped to disk, and therefore I can automatically find this memory location on disk through some kind of table. That doesn't exist. What happens when the processor tries to access a virtual memory location that is actually in swap space, like down here, if process 0 tries to access its second virtual page, the page table entry for process 0 would have to have a 0 bit in the present area of the page table entry, indicating to the CPU that actually this page is not in memory, so you need to trigger a page fault exception and let the OS handle it in its interrupt handler for page table exceptions, or page fault exceptions. So then at that point, you know, your OS code would take over and figure out what was going on and where, and it would somehow remember that it placed that page over here in block one of swap space, and it would then make a decision of what to do. And the decision is probably going to be to place it in one of these four physical frame numbers, but in order to do that, in this case, it has to make space by taking someone out. So that's the general process of page faults when things are swapped out, evictions to take pages out of memory to make space, and then the placement of the demanded page in memory. Okay. I'm getting a little ahead of myself there, but you can see from this diagram that there are four processes, and process 3, this white colored process, is actually entirely in swap space. So we can imagine that maybe this is a process, maybe the OS has decided to put this process entirely in swap space because it wasn't really doing anything. It hasn't done anything recently. Or maybe it just made a bad decision and put process 3 in swap space, even though it is going to have to do something soon and it'll have to transfer it back to memory. Okay. All right. So how does this work? What are the mechanics, or what's the mechanism for swapping? Like I alluded to earlier, the main thing you have to remember is that it's done through the page tables, and this is the same page table entry I showed before, but this present bit down here is used not just it's a generic indication of whether a page is present in memory. It can be used not just, as we saw before, not just to indicate that a process doesn't have any memory in that range, but also to indicate that, okay, maybe the process is using that virtual memory range, but the OS has decided to remove that page from physical memory and to swap it to disk. So all this bit does, it's an indicator to the CPU to create an exception, to transfer control to the operating system, to interrupt that user process if the user process tries to access a virtual memory location corresponding to this page. In other words, with a where the index into the page table from the high bits of the virtual address lead to this page table entry. Okay. Which may lead to the question, how does the OS know how to react to a page fault if it can happen for multiple reasons? I think the next slide talks about that, but one thing you may notice is that if you create a page table entry where this present bit is set to zero, then this page-based address, the translation stored up here, actually is never used because the CPU doesn't see that as a valid entry. So the operating system can store some information in that memory location. Remember, this page table entry is just part of kernel memory, so the kernel can take advantage of it as a convenient data structure for storing information about the page that the CPU is not necessarily going to use, but the operating system can use. So in this particular case, for swapping, you can store some kind of disk address in these bits up here. And you can even use these lower bits, 9 through 11, that are just marked as available. So you have up to, 23 bits in which to store a disk address or an index into an array, maybe, that you have in kernel memory that lists the location of the swapped page, something like that. Okay, but when, so when you're swapping a page to disk, you have to find the corresponding page table entry for that virtual address range, set the present bit to zero, and then copy the page to a disk location, and then somehow keep track of what that disk location is so that later when you get a page fault for that range, you know where to find it. The easiest way to do that is to use the high bits of the page table entry to record the disk address. Okay? We haven't talked about file systems and disks in detail yet, so don't worry too much about what a disk address is. It could mean a bunch of different things depending on the file system. And depending on how swap space is organized. But just think about it abstractly as an address. Okay. Like I said, page faults occur when the page table entry is marked not present and the CPU is trying to do a virtual address translation. The CPU's hardware circuitry is designed to traverse page tables. It finds a page table entry, sees a zero bit in the present, sees a zero in the present bit, and causes an exception. When that happens, the important thing for x86 anyway is that the CPU doesn't just trigger an exception, but it sets a certain control register, CR2, to store the offending virtual address, and then it generates the page fault exception to start the OS code to handle page faults. So when the OS takes over to handle the page fault, it doesn't just know that an exception occurred, but it knows exactly what the virtual address was that caused that exception, and then it also has it also knows which process was running because it scheduled that process, right? If it using the CR2 register, it can find the page table entry in memory corresponding to it, and then it can dig out that file, the disk address from the high bits of the page table entry. Okay, so when there's a page fault exception, there are several possibilities. Option one, if the process made an invalid memory access, that means, for example, it tried to read an address that was never allocated to the process by the OS, so the OS never set up a page table entry for that process, like a null pointer exception in Project 2. Or if it tried to write to a page that the OS marked as read only, remember that there's this read-write bit that the OS can set for a page. Or if the process tried to read from kernel memory, or write to kernel memory, because there's also a bit in the page table entry that indicates whether a page is only available in privileged mode. Okay? In all those cases, when there's an invalid memory access, probably what the OS will do to handle it is just to kill the process, because the process did something wrong, and there's no way for the OS to make it right. So, tell the user segmentation fault or something like that and crash the process. Option two is the case we're interested in today, which is when it wasn't the process's fault, it was the OS's fault that there was a page fault, because the OS decided that process didn't need that page anymore, it swapped it out to disk, it set that present bit to zero. The program didn't do anything wrong, it's just unlucky. Or maybe it's to blame in the sense that it was using too much memory and the OS had no choice but to swap out some memory. Okay. But the OS at this point has to swap in that page and retry the last instruction. So how do you distinguish between these two cases? Yeah. To distinguish between these two cases, the interrupt handler can check the high bits of the page table entry, which, like I said, are not used by the CPU, but can be used to store information used by the OS. So for example, one simple way to implement this would be, if you're, you know, as an OS, you can set all these high bits to zero, all zeros, if a page is missing simply because the process is not using that memory. So you'd check for all zeros. Otherwise, if there's a number up there, then that would mean that it corresponds to a file system location for a swapped page. Okay. Questions? Okay. So if swap space is being used, that means that RAM is in short supply. We don't generally want to use swap space unless we have to because it's slow. And we're trying to swap in. That means that we probably have to evict a page to make room for the demanded page. Evict just means kick out or remove. Okay. So we need some kind of page replacement policy to determine which page we're going to evict. But we don't want to do it randomly because every time this swapping happens, it's expensive. We have to go to the disk. It's 10,000 times slower than memory. We only want to swap the minimum number of times possible. So there's a huge penalty, and we want to be wise about it, and we can afford the time to be deliberate and careful about making this decision because we know that the cost of a mistake is very high. And the important observation is that if we evict a page that's not going to be used at all or infrequently, then there's really no penalty. It can live happily on disk as long as it doesn't need to be, that data doesn't need to be used. There are no instructions on there that need to run. There's no data in that range that needs to be accessed in the near future. Okay. All right. I have a cool demo of that I want to show of magnetic disks. So I'm sure that you all are familiar with magnetic disks, but I don't know if you've all seen
an advertisement.
Okay. Yeah. Great. This is a minute and a half long. All right, so this is a magnetic disk, desktop sized. Yeah. This is probably a few years ago. So you see how the disk spins, and there's an arm here that reads out the disk like a record player. And actually, there are many different arms. Right, see how fast it moves, too? So 20 times in a quarter of a second. But this is in slow motion now. We can actually see it spinning, and you can see the arm moving. This is like 40 times slower than real speed. And you see how many layers there are of platters and arms? So this is just like for fun. Okay, that's the part you shouldn't try at home. Okay, and actually, if you took the lid off of a disk and ran it like this, it wouldn't work anymore, because any tiny particle of dust or anything that gets anywhere in the mechanism will break it. Okay, so, yeah. I thought that was pretty cool. But it's amazing that these things actually last for several years, spinning like that constantly, and having that really fast motion of the arm. But even though it looks fast, that time scale of like spinning the disk about 7,200 times per minute, and the arm moving from like front to back in maybe tens of microseconds, something like that. It seems pretty fast, but on this time scale that the processor works, it's very, very slow. And the reason I wanted to show that video is because you can see that there's a lot of latency and there's a lot of parallelism involved. Let me talk about what I mean by that. So we talk about speed. For I/O, speed can mean a lot of different things, actually. It can mean, particularly, it can mean throughput or could mean latency. So throughput is bytes per second. This is kind of when you think of like an internet connection speed or like some kind of connection speed, transfer speed, you might think about bytes per second. And that makes sense for long running big transfers. But another important measure is the latency, which is the delay before the action starts or the delay before you can get even a small amount of information. So if you're, and these two measures have different characteristics. So latency is always higher for large and distant storage devices. So for example, the latency of a magnetic disk is bigger than SSD, bigger than RAM, bigger than L3 cache, L2, L1, and the registers. And the reason these things are ordered like this is really just because of their size and distance. You know, you can think about the speed of light being a limitation of information transfer at about 30 centimeters per nanosecond. A nanosecond is roughly the amount of time it takes for the processor to do something, one clock tick. So in that time that the processor it does a little bit of work, information can only travel 30 centimeters, right? So, and latency for a disk, which you saw in the video, there are reasons why a disk has high latency because there's mechanical rotation and there's seek. Seek means the arm moving back and forth. So, obviously, if the data is stored on a disk, you can't read randomly from any part of the disk. The reads only happen on the tip of that arm. So you can only read from wherever that thing is pointed. So you have to wait not only for the arm to move, this is called seeking, to seek left or right to the right track, the right ring of the disk. You also have to wait for the disk to turn such that whatever piece of the disk you want to read, if you want to read this piece of the disk, it has to rotate around this way, and the arm has to move down to here, right? Both of those mechanical actions have to take place. The rotation tends to be slower than the seeking because this disk is big and heavy, whereas the arm is smaller and lighter. But the important thing is that if we're just accessing a random part of the disk, this read head has to move in two different dimensions. Physical motion is slow. It's a piece of metal that has to move. However, your throughput from the disk can actually be very fast, even though the disk is far away from the CPU. The reason the throughput can be fast is because you can parallelize it, and you can read from contiguous areas of the disk. So for example, if I make this a little bit neater, so if this is the disk spinning around, and you have the read head over here at some place in the disk is rotating. At this moment in time, you can read this particular location, and you notice also that there are many platters. There are like four different platters, different layers of disk, and there are many different arms. Okay, picture's getting bad. And also every platter has a top and a bottom side. So there are four different platters in that picture, with tops and bottoms, so eight different platters to read off of, eight different arms, so you can read eight different locations at once. Okay, that's starting to look a little bit better. But then also, if your data is laid out contiguously, basically along an arc on this track, like if you have some data along this path, and also below it along that path, like on all eight different layers along that path, you can, as this disk is rotating, you can scan through all of those segments, right? So in some sense, you've minimized the penalty of the mechanical delay involved in the system by using the spatial locality, like basically looking at adjacent parts of the disk, looking at parts of the disk that we know are going to be visited soon because the disk is always spinning. We don't control the spinning of the disk. We just control the arm sliding back and forth. And then we utilize the multiple layers of the disk at the same time. So if we have a big data chunk, like a big page that we're swapping to disk, what we'd probably end up doing is storing it in such a way that it was distributed like this, like on arcs that were on the eight different platters of the disk, and so that to start reading this page laid out like this, if the arm was in a different location and this disk was rotated to a different angle, you would have to wait a while. There would be a big latency while the arm moved to the right place and the disk rotated to the right place. But once it got there, all of a sudden you'd be slammed with a lot of data that would come in all at once in parallel. Okay. So the moral of this story, like from the video, the picture, and this discussion, is that small IOs to disk are just as slow as large ones. So it doesn't make sense to just read a tiny bit of data from a disk. You might as well try to get a large chunk of data, because you're going to have to wait a long time to get started anyway. And so we try to batch IO requests together, just package them together to do large requests instead of small requests. Okay, that makes sense? Yep. Well, the platters always turn together. They're all connected to the same like motor that turns them at the same time. So I think that kind of answers that question. Okay, so in case this still isn't clear, postal analogy, just for fun, if we think about mailing a letter in a package, this is kind of like using a disk, where the letter represents a small disk I.O., and the package represents a big disk I.O. So if we send a small letter or a big package, both to Los Angeles, although this is actually addressed to Chicago, ignore that, they'll take roughly the same amount of time to get there, because they both are traveling on an airplane or on a truck. The latency is the same for these two mailings. However, the big package transfers more information at once. So the package is a batch transfer. The latency of these two communication mechanisms is the same, but the throughput of the package is higher. Okay? Yeah. So bundle your disk, your IOs into big chunks, especially for disks. So we have some choices about when to swap, actually. There's a scheme called demand paging, where we swap pages in response to page faults. This is the simplest approach, and this is kind of what I described so far. Basically, you wait until you run out of space, page fault happens, and then you have to swap something in. You have to swap something out and then swap something in. In reality, this would happen asynchronously in the sense that you get a interrupt for the page fault, and then you at that point you'd want to start reading and writing to the disk. You don't have to wait for that to finish before you go on. Actually, since the disk is going to take a long time to do its work, you would block the process and the scheduler would run another process at that time. Okay, that's demand paging. But the a more interesting way to do this is background swapping. With background swapping, you actually are preemptive about swapping pages. So even though there wasn't a page fault, even though no one needs space to store another page, you still make space sometimes. Just because you don't want to run into a scenario where you suddenly run out of space and you have to react slowly by moving something out. So in this case, with background swapping, you have a swap daemon, which is just a background process, like a system program running on the OS that runs every so often, periodically, sort of like the scheduler does. And every time it runs, it makes a decision about whether it's going to swap. And it swaps if the number of free physical frames is small, smaller than some low water mark is the term they use. So if there is not enough space in RAM, then the background swap daemon makes some space by evicting some pages, and it actually evicts some pages until it reaches a high water mark, which is greater than the low water mark. So it doesn't just want to ensure that there's a minimum number of pages, it wants to ensure that when it starts clearing stuff out, it clears out a decent amount of stuff. It doesn't just, because we know that writing large blocks to disk is more efficient than writing small blocks. Like that's what I was talking about before with the throughput and latency of the disks. Okay, they have a different low water mark and high water mark. You could also think of this as a hysteresis, in a sense. Like, for example, with a thermostat in a HVAC system, if you have the temperature set to 75 degrees, what might happen is if it gets cold, temperature drops down to 74 degrees, turns on the heat, and actually keeps the heat going until it reaches like 77 degrees, just so that it doesn't have to constantly switch the heat off and on, because that's bad for the heater, basically. This is another system that works like that, because it's bad for the disk, or it's like inefficient to just swap out a little bit of stuff at a time. Okay. Question? Okay. Alright, so background swapping avoids long, unexpected delays in allocating memory. So if you have a background swap process, you always have some free pages, at least the low watermark number. So if a program does a malloc, which ends up needing more space or something, or you start running a new program, that should be able to happen very quickly, because there's some reserve of free pages in the system, right? It also reduces page fault latency, because you don't necessarily have to make a free up some space before you bring something in. You can just bring the page in. So it ends up being one, just a read instead of both a write and a read. So in other words, you don't have to kick something out before you pull something in. And this background swapping process can be scheduled with low priority. So even though it's a system process, it's not an essential system process. You can just run it whenever there's idle time on the machine, and this takes advantage of idle time to prepare for future work. This is a common pattern in systems. On Linux, the swap daemon is a process called kswapd. So if you look at the running processes on a Linux machine, you'll probably see that. Note on terminology, swapping is sometimes called paging, and so sometimes I'll call it paging, and the background process is sometimes called page daemon. The reason it's called paging instead of swapping, and paging is kind of a dumb term because pages are the things you're moving around, but sometimes we use the term paging instead of swapping because sometimes your swapping always refers to moving things to disk and using disk as a backup, like a backup store for RAM. But sometimes paging is more about handling lazy allocation, which I'll talk about later, which is not really swapping. So that was a little confusing, but here it is. Lazy allocation, lazy loading. All right, so page faults paging is not really just used to handle memory overflow. So swapping is about memory overflow, but the more general concept of paging is not just for memory overflow. It's also an opportunity to improve performance by being lazy in fulfilling certain requests. And in particular, it allows us to reduce program start time by lazily allocating memory and lazily loading the programs. So what do I mean by that? If a process uses the SBREAK or MMAP system calls to request a chunk of memory, like a large chunk of memory in particular, that can take a long time for the process to set up the page tables, to maybe swap things out, to make space. But as an OS, we might want to be a little bit skeptical and think that maybe the program is not going to use all that memory. At least it's not going to use it immediately, right? And our observation from using systems is that programmers and compilers are sometimes pretty greedy in their requests. So a program might request like a gigabyte of memory, but in reality it only uses 100 megabytes, one-tenth of the space. Or a program is written and compiled in such a way that the binary file is like 100 megabytes large, but in reality it only uses code in one-tenth of that space. So binaries are bloated with big libraries that sometimes are never used, and memory allocations can be inefficient, too big, right? If the OS is obedient to the program, it might slow down the program more than the program needs, like slower than necessary. So what the OS can do is, when it gets an allocation request, or it gets an exec request to like load a file to run as an executable, a new process, it can kind of virtually do that allocation, but mark most of those pages as not present. So for example, if a program uses the SBREAK system call to request a gigabyte of additional memory, So in a simple way of doing that, the OS would go through the page table, that process, to set up new pages for that process. It would actually look in physical memory to find pages, page frames to store that new memory. It would do some evictions to clear out space for that 1 gigabyte of space. But if we're not sure the program is really going to use all that memory, then it probably doesn't make sense to do all those evictions ahead of time, right? Like, let's wait and see. That's kind of the idea here. Wait and see if the program really needs all that memory. So instead, you set up the pages as not present with that bit I was talking about, kind of as if, it's like you're simulating the fact that you allocated the memory, you set it up, but then swapped it out. Except you don't really have to do that. You just never load it in the first place. Okay. So if the CPU ends up using that memory, it'll find that not present bit, it'll raise an exception, and then the OS, if it was keeping track of things properly, it'll realize why that was, and then it'll actually do the allocation that it had delayed from previously. Right? So lazy allocation. The program asks you for a certain amount of memory, you tell it that you gave it to it, but you don't actually give it to it until it actually uses it. And the page table lets you do that. Same thing applies for binaries, you know, code instructions. You just load the first page of instructions, and then for the rest of them, you load them on demand. And you could even load them from the binary file as needed from the file system. Questions about that? Okay. All right, so let's have a break. We'll start again in 4 minutes. That would be 1:22. let's get started again. So far I've talked about the mechanisms for page replacement and the motivation for swapping. In the next half of the lecture, I'm going to talk about page replacement policies. And this is similar in spirit to the discussion we had about translation look-aside buffers. So translation look-aside buffers are a cache for page tables, and you can design a policy to evict elements of the translation look-aside buffer that tries to optimize the hit rate and minimize the miss rate. And the same thing applies here. So when we access a page, we either have a hit or a miss. And a hit means that the page was in physical memory and it can proceed quickly. But a miss means that the page was swapped out to disk and that's going to be slow because we have to swap it back in. Right? When the time comes to evict a page, we want to choose one that will not be used again soon. And the general strategy we use is to use the recent history of past memory accesses to try to predict the future. Because if we know what's going to happen in the future, then we can make a good decision about what to leave in memory and what to swap out. So page faults are actually much more costly than TLB misses because they involve going to disk. Disk is really slow. So we can afford to spend some time and energy implementing a good sophisticated policy for page replacement, right? And whenever we talk about page replacement, the term memory pressure means that we're in a situation where there's a high demand for memory. I guess it's pretty self-explanatory. If there's no memory pressure, then it doesn't really matter what the page replacement policy is, because there won't be any swapping. There'll be enough memory for everyone to use at the same time. So here's a quasi-mathematical, but not really, formulation for the page replacement policy, the definition of the problem. So we're given a small number of page frames. That's our budget, our RAM space. We have this larger number of virtual pages. All the different processes have virtual pages. And then we have a sequence of memory accesses from the processes, which you can translate into just a sequence of virtual page demands. Okay. Based on that, we want to choose a mapping of virtual pages to physical frames at each time step. So in other words, at every point in time, we have a choice to configure the page table in any way we see fit. However, there's some constraints. No two virtual pages can map to the same physical page at the same time. This just means that physical pages can uniquely store one page, can't store two pages at the same time. And that if that sequence of memory accesses demands a certain virtual page at a given time step, then that virtual page has to be mapped to a physical page. It cannot be unmapped. That virtual page has to be in memory. And we want to minimize the changes in the mapping over time. So we have to be careful. We want to be careful about that sequence of mappings to minimize the number of swaps. So ideally, we can meet the demands of the memory accesses without doing a lot of changes to the mapping. Okay. So if we can predict the future, this would be easy. And specifically, the optimal page replacement policy is to replace the page that will be accessed furthest into the future. So that whatever page is not going to be used for the longest amount of time, that's the page you should swap to disk. I think that makes a lot of sense, intuitively. You'll end up leaving in memory the pages that you're going to use soon, and then as a result, those accesses in the near future are not going to have any penalty for swapping. Of course, this is not a practical policy because we can't predict the future in reality. Or we can predict it, but we can't foresee it exactly. However, this optimal policy is useful for constructing simulations to compare real policies to this optimal policy. So this optimal policy is a performance upper bound. If we're interested in designing a policy for page replacement, then we can compare the performance of our real algorithm with a simulation of that same program execution with an optimal policy, where we kind of cheat and we let the simulation look into the future, because in a simulation, you have all the data for the future. Yes? No. it's an unrealistic policy because you have to know what's going to happen in the future. I mean, you could try to approximate it. So the mechanism, I'm going to talk later about a mechanism called the accessed bit. So in the page table, there the hardware actually will set a bit in the page table entry if it happens to use a certain memory location. So that creates that ends up storing information about like what parts of memory are being used over time. So you can the OS can check that to see like what part of memory was used. So that gives you information about what was happening in the past, which is a mechanism that allows you to approximate this policy. But I mean, I don't know of anything that... Another thing you could do, you could actually try to do program analysis if you're intelligent, like really clever. I don't know if anyone that does this, unless it was if you had a compiler that like collaborated with the operating system, but... If you had information about the program, basically, you could actually tell what it was going to do in the future, because to some extent, most code isn't totally predictable, but some code is predictable. So you could try to leverage that, but I don't have a good answer for that. Right. So like I said, you can use this as a simulation to do upper bound performance analysis. I want you to notice, here's a simulation of a program running through, like, I don't know, 10 steps, and it accesses certain virtual pages, and in this case, I think in this example, there are only 3 physical pages, but there are 4 virtual pages, 0 through 3, and then just 3 areas to store pages. And in this trace, you can see that the first 3 memory accesses are misses, because initially we start off with an empty cache. So in this case, we've kind of backed away from the idea of swapping and in RAM. We're just talking about caches in general. That's because the memory disk system is really just a special case of a cache in general. So this discussion applies to both paging and TLBs and other kinds of caches, even like a web browser cache for web requests. But initially, if we don't have any history, then the requests are going to be expensive because we have to fill in the cache. That's the first 3. Then as we go down, if you just are keeping track, if there ever is a miss, like suddenly on step 6, we start using memory address 3, which we've never used before. The cache is already full, so we can't pull something in. We have to evict something to choose the eviction victim. We look into the future to find which of these 3 addresses in memory, 0, 1, 2, is going to be used furthest in the future. And that ends up being 2 down here. So we evict 2. Right? But like I said, we're looking into the future, which you can't really do in reality. Now, if we know that... we know that the furthest in the future policy is optimal, then we should try to approximate something close to that. And one way to do that was with least recently used. Assuming that there is temporal and spatial locality, in other words, you can try to use the recent history to predict the future. If you know that predicting the future is the way to go, then look at the recent history to try to predict the future. That's kind of the logic behind it. With this policy, you evict the virtual page. You evict the virtual page that was least recently used, and you assume that somehow like we're done using that memory, and we've moved on to some other memory. So that's what you do. It's a pretty simple policy. Whether it works well in practice depends on your workload. In other words, the specific sequence of accesses. But if that workload has temporal and spatial locality, then it will work well. In other words, if your workload tends to access the same stuff repeatedly, or stuff near what you've been working on, then throwing out least recently used data is a good policy, because you probably won't use it again. Okay. There are some problems with least recently used. It suffers from what they call corner case behaviors, meaning like just weird artificial sequences that kind of trick the system. So if we are using the same example of three physical pages and four virtual pages, and we have the following access pattern, like 1234, 1234, 1234, or you know, in the specific, I should have started to match the diagram before. It should be 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. But anyway, if we just go in sequence and loop around, LREU policy will actually have a page miss every single time. Because we have space for three in the cache. And so if we just imagine execution somewhere in the middle, like here after the two, the items in cache will be the last three, 4, 1, 2, and 3. But the one that we're accessing is always right before the last three, because it's every four we repeat it. So every time we move on to another item, the one that we've just evicted is exactly the one we're going to use next. And that just happens to be because of the we're not looking back far enough to capture the repetition, the pattern data. This LRU only remembers the past three accesses, but the repetition happens on a longer time scale of four. So this LRU will be really bad in this example, even though the optimal policy is still optimal, because it's always optimal, and this kind of seems like it should approximate the optimal policy. For this particular workload, LRU does not approximate optimal at all. In this case, actually, a random eviction policy does pretty well. And random policies tend to avoid worst-case behaviors, and they're simple to implement. So what I mean by random eviction policy, I just mean that if you have a page fault, just randomly choose one of the page frames to clear out. It's likely that you will not cause a big problem because you have a lot of choices, but it's also possible that you would have randomly chosen something that you were just using, and therefore you should know better that you're probably going to use it again. But then again, it's also unlikely that you're going to just randomly choose to evict the exact frame that you're going to use next. So random is a policy that's like, it's simple and it avoids really bad behaviors, but it also avoids really good behaviors. Because it doesn't really have any smarts. So when doing an OS performance analysis in general, no one policy actually will work for every program in every scenario. That's one thing that the previous example showed us. Even though least recently used, it seems like a pretty sensible policy for handling swapping. If you have this looping behavior, it doesn't work well. So if you're testing an OS or any complex software system, you have to be careful about the workload that you use, like what scenario you run the system through to test your policies, and how you choose that workload will influence your results. And if you choose an unrealistic workload, then people won't believe your results or will argue with it, and quite rightly so. And so this is one of the reasons why people are still designing operating systems and changing operating systems, because it's hard to really ever be sure that something is designed well, and also because over time workloads change as new programs are written, as new programming languages and compilers are written that end up producing programs that behave a little bit differently, even for the same problem. And of course, different types of applications are developed, like smartphone applications tend to work differently than server-based applications and so forth. But what in creating a workload, you want, and sometimes it's called a benchmark. Like you can download benchmark programs, for example, to test, you know, how fast is my computer? How fast is my CPU? That's not a clear thing. You could have two computers where one runs a certain program faster, but then the other runs a different program faster. It depends on what program you run. And same thing's true of benchmarks. But benchmarks and workloads are supposed to be like a mix of different programs that reflect different commonly used programming paradigms and should somehow, as a whole, have some meaningful reflection of the performance of the system. Okay. So here's some diagrams from the book, which I wanted to put up because it could be a little confusing, perhaps. But it's an example of two different workflows evaluating these page replacement policies. So on the left, the 80-20 workload is a synthetic workload that, like, it's a sequence of memory accesses that are generated using the rule that 80% of the accesses should access 20% of the memory. So, and this is kind of, somehow we think this is reasonable because we know that programs don't behave randomly. We know that they tend to reuse the same data, but we know that they don't totally always reuse the same data. Sometimes they use random data. So it's like a mix of the two things. Like 80% of the time, the program is not using random data. It's using just 20% of the data. But then 20% of the time, it's drawing randomly from the full range of data. It behaves kind of randomly. And in that case, blue shows the optimal policy's performance in terms of the hit rate. And then on the x-axis is the cache size. So if you make the cache large enough, like in this case, if the size of the memory of the RAM is so big that there's never any swapping, then it doesn't matter what your swapping policy is, because you're never actually going to swap. That's why everything converges to 100% hit rate up there. But as you create more memory pressure by making the memory smaller, it starts to matter what you're doing with swapping, right? And in particular, different policies behave differently for this particular workload. Least recently used works pretty well for an 80-20 workload because, you know, in the 80-20 workload, you have certain, like, hot pages, which are these 20% pages that are commonly used 80% of the time. And then if they're commonly used, they will not fit the definition of being least recently used. Therefore, they'll not be evicted, so they'll tend to stay in memory. That's why that tends to perform well compared to, like, a random policy, which is shown on that on the lower line, the yellow line. On the right is this looping sequential workload, which is the example that works really poorly for least recently used, where you just go like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. In that case, you never are using the most recently used, the next thing you read is always the least recently used data, because as soon as you read something, you never use it again until you've used everything else again. And in that case, the performance of least recently used is shown here is terrible. Like, it always misses unless you can fit everything in memory. That's what this breakpoint is. But the random policy actually does a lot better, even though it doesn't have any smarts, because somehow it'll sometimes randomly make a choice to keep useful data in memory. Okay. So talking about mechanisms again, which I alluded to earlier, to implement least recently used, you don't have a direct way of doing that because, you know, memory accesses are not privileged instructions, unlike some of you said in the homework. You can't access every part of memory, but in general, if you're accessing your own memory, the CPU will let you do that. You won't get interrupted by the OS for doing that. So the OS does not know what memory you've been using, actually. But the CPU hardware, thankfully, provides some nice features to help us. And the two features that it provides are the dirty and accessed bits in the page table entry up here. Okay. So whenever this is particular to the Intel x86 processor, other processors have something equivalent to help the OS. But basically, whenever the hardware does a page table lookup because it's accessing a certain range of memory on behalf of a user program, it will set the accessed bit to record, you know, hey, I just used this memory. And also, and that's for reads or writes. But if it writes to that memory, it also sets another bit, because that's another important case. Because the OS might want to know not just whether we read from memory, but if we wrote to certain memory. Okay, so basically what I'm saying is that the CPU, it doesn't interrupt programs reading and writing to memory, but it does record where they're writing to memory in a brief summary form in the page table, right? It's just on a per-page granularity. And then the OS can, when it's just trying to decide who to evict, it can actually go through the page tables and check these bits. Now, this isn't giving you a lot of information. It's just yes or no. Was this ever read or written to? But what the OS can do is periodically reset that down to zero when it does the check. So the OS knows, okay, I just checked this 5 seconds ago. I set everyone to zero. And then I'm checking it again now, and I see that these 10 pages were read. So therefore, I know that in the past 10 seconds, or past 5 seconds, these 10 pages are read. Everything else was not read in the past 5 seconds. So there you go. That is perhaps enough information for the OS to construct a reasonable policy that looks like least recently used. It's not exactly least recently used, but it's like an approximation. Okay. And so the clock algorithm is a very basic implementation where the OS would keep a circular linked list of all the pages, and it kind of goes through all the pages. When it needs to evict something, it's looking at a certain point and say, okay, have you been accessed? If not, then I'm going to evict you. You haven't been accessed recently. But if you have been accessed, I'll move on to the next page. I'll keep looking for someone who has not been accessed, who's kind of least recently used. Not least recently used, but not recently used, let's say. But in doing that scan, it also, as it goes, it sets the access bits to zero so that next time around, it'll know whether it was accessed just in that time window since the last time it checked, not over the whole history, right? And it can start off where it left off in that circular list, so that kind of treats everyone fairly. Yeah, question? What an eviction looks like is setting the present bit to zero. Okay, well, first of all, using this translation to figure out where in physical memory the page currently is, taking that memory and copying it to swap space so that it's preserved, right? And then, I mean, there's some other algorithm for figuring out where in the swap space we're going to store it, like what space is available in swap space. Let's ignore that for now, but you can imagine it being similar to what we talked about with malloc, like with a free list looking for free spaces. Okay, so it knows where on the file system it stored the page. So now it has a file system address that it can actually store in the page table entry up here, set the present bit to zero. And the main thing is, by setting the present bit to zero, next time the program tries to read from that area, it'll cause a page fault. And the fact that we set some bits up here in the high area means that we'll know that that page is on disk and where on disk it is. Okay. All right. So there's also the dirty bit, which is a little weird, but so it's useful actually for the OS to know not just which data is being used recently, but also which data. Which pages are being written to, and which ones are read-only. Because it turns out that read-only pages are good candidates for eviction. The reason that read-only pages are good candidates for eviction is because whatever data is in that page is probably already stored somewhere in the file system. Like it's not necessary to copy that out to the file system first, because although that data was present in memory, it didn't change from the last time, from wherever it came from, and it probably came from the file system in the first place. So if the OS can track where that page came from somehow, and it knows that the page was never written to, then it can simply, if it needs to swap out that page, it can just throw it out without writing it to disk, and assuming that it knows where it came from, and it can replace it from the original source. And there are a couple of different cases. So for example, if you have a page of instructions from a code binary, those are actually read-only. Not only are they not going to be dirty, but they'll have a bit probably set on the page table entry that says that they're read-only. And that's another way you can detect read-only pages. Read and execute only, basically non-writable pages. So in that case, the OS knows exactly like what file and what part of that file that page came from. So it can reread the instructions from the file. And slightly more complicated, if you have a data page, like in the heap memory, that was allocated for a process, and you didn't set it up as read-only because the process has the right to write, has the ability and the privilege to write to that page, but if it chooses not to write to that page, then actually you can, and if you happen to, if that page was previously swapped to disk, and when you copied it from swap to main memory, you never deleted the swapped copy, you could actually just throw out the memory copy and refer back to the old copy that you hadn't swapped. That saves you some time. Throwing out a read-only page is a lot faster because somehow the information in that page is not, it's not new information, you have it somewhere else, either in swap space from a previous swapping or on disk from a code binary. Okay. So the final topic real quick that I want to cover, this term thrashing is actually pretty useful, a useful concept to know for real world programming. If you ever write a program that uses too much memory, you'll run into thrashing. So we know that virtual memory and swapping kind of give you the ability to use a lot of memory, but there's no free lunch, really. Like, if you just use way too much memory and you have way too many processes using memory, things are going to be dog slow. Nothing is going to run is going to run well because swapping is very slow. Swapping, occasional swapping is fine if you can move out parts of memory that are not really being used, that the program claims it needs but doesn't really need. But if you have processes that are all using a lot of memory and they really need to use all that memory frequently, then they're all going to be competing for memory, and there's going to be a lot of swapping. That's called thrashing. So there are ways to monitor your system to see how many page faults are occurring. On Linux, for example, the top command is just one of many ways to see, but there's like a, you can add a column to the view that shows the number of page faults per process, so you can see if programs are doing a lot of page faults. And so if it looks like a program is frozen, often what it means is that it's trying to use too much memory and it's thrashing. It's just swapping all the time. So in that particular case, a good reaction might be to kill some processes. Even though technically you have the swap space available to allow those programs to run, no one's making any progress because everyone's swapping all the time. This is a case where it's better to do one thing well than to do many things poorly because there's such a huge cost to swapping. Okay? Any questions? All right, see y'all next time.